All right. So far we are talking about a unit cell which is tagged in three directions, right? And we have not talked about any issues with the orientation mismatches. So these things are called single crystals. Until now what we have talked about is single crystal. That means the crystallographic orientation is unique. Okay? The single crystal materials are extremely important materials for several technological applications, right? For instance, you use single crystal silicon for semiconductor applications, and turbine blades, for instance, are required to withstand very high temperatures, right? Have you heard of a steam turbine and a gas turbine in your advanced thermodynamics courses, right? Application of thermodynamics courses. So there, these components are subjected to very high temperatures, right? You ideally want to operate them at high temperatures in order to increase the thermal efficiency. So when they are working at high temperatures, they are subjected to a phenomena called thermal creep, and you want to have materials which have high strength at high temperature. So if you want to have something like that, you want to make the materials with single crystals so that you the material will provide very high thermal creep resistance. Okay, so that's why the turbine blades are usually made of single crystal materials. And again, if you have single crystal copper, it is known to show better electrical conductivity compared to a polycrystalline gap. Okay, again, the lasers that we use in pointers, they are all sapphire lasers, so they are again single crystal materials. So there are several technological applications for these single crystal materials, but there are several other applications where we use polycrystalline materials. What is a polycrystalline material? Most of the crystalline solids that we use in our engineering applications are polycrystalline in nature. So, for instance, if you are growing a solid, crystalline solid from a liquid state, okay, and then when you are growing this, when you are solidifying your liquid metal, then what happens is there will be several nucleation sites, right? So first there should be a nucleation, and then slowly it gets solidified, the material gets solidified. So for instance, in this picture you can see that there are different nucleation sites, and each one of them having their own orientation, isn't it? So when all of them meet together, you have incompatibility at the position. So this is one crystal. This is crystal 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And 1 and 2 are meeting, there is an incompatibility in terms of orientation. Right? And this is what we call this is one grain and this is another grain. This is what you call a grain boundary. So this crystal has one orientation, this crystal has another orientation. Right? And this is what we call a polycrystalline material, because the polycrystalline material will have several grains. Each one of these grains have their own orientation, right? Had it been a single crystal, it has one single orientation. Everywhere, there is no grain boundary. There is no incompatibility between each of these crystals, right? Each of these grains. So when they come together, you will not see any incompatibility, and you will see that it's a single grain. You think that it is a single grain, right? So most of our materials are polycrystalline. And hence, we need to understand what happens when you have a polycrystalline material to the deformation mechanism. That is something that we will discuss in the next module. And it is important to know that it is extremely difficult to actually make a single crystal material. Why is it very difficult? If you were to make a single crystal material, what is that you need to do? Suppose this, you are coming from liquid state to solid state. What is that we need to do? You need to control the nucleation sites, right? You can only have one nucleation site, and you should not have several nucleation sites. And then from one nucleation site only, you should be solidifying the material, so that the crystal orientation will not be having any incompatibility with the neighboring crystal, because there is no neighboring crystal. But to do that, you have to do the solidification process extreme with extreme care, and that will increase the fabrication production cost, and hence the cyclic crystal materials are usually very expensive compared to your polycrystalline materials. Right? That is why your turbine blades have to be made with utmost care, and then obviously the cost is going to go up. Okay. All right. And what do you, when we are talking about a single crystal material, we have seen that. So, if you take a unit cell and you stack them in all the directions, and then we know that we have different crystallographic planes, each have different crystallographic planar density. Each plane has different density, each plane has different linear density, and hence, when you are, let us say you take a crystal and you are applying a load, you are pulling the crystal, you are applying, you are doing a tensile test, which you have done in your previous, have you done a applied mechanics, have you completed your applied mechanics lab? So, you must have done the tensile test on a polycrystalline material, right? What you have done is you have applied a load and then you are pulling, right? When you are pulling, what are you doing? What is actually happening within the material? When you are applying an external load, what is happening to the atoms? The atomic bonds are getting stretched, right? That is what happens first. And if you are in the elastic regime, then what happens? As soon as you remove the load, it goes back. That means atomic bond is not broken, it is only getting stretched. And that is what you mean by elasticity, right? So, depending on, so that means you have some, so when you apply a load, you get a displacement. So, if you apply, when you have, you can actually plot a stress strain curve. And now, depending upon which direction you are applying load, right? If you are loading is in 100 direction or 111 direction or 110 direction, the amount of resistance offered by the material to this deformation is going to be different, right? In other words, the stiffness offered by the crystal will be different depending upon the direction of the load that you have applied. And hence, the material property, that is, for instance, the elastic modulus of the material is not going to be the same in all the directions. It changes from one direction to another direction. So, for instance, if you take aluminum, right? If you are loading the material in 100 direction, then you will measure an elastic modulus of 63.7. If you take a single crystal aluminum and then you apply the load in 100 direction, your elastic modulus will be 63.7 GPa. If you do the same thing in 110 and 111, again you will measure the elastic modulus to be different. And so is the case for all other materials. For copper, you will see much larger difference, right? In 100, it is much softer, but, and here it is much stiffer, 130.3. And 111 is the stiffness, right? So, this means the material does not have the same property in all the directions, and hence it is, in by definition, it is an anisotropic material. It will not show you the same property. Have you observed different elastic moduli depending on which direction you cut your sample in your laboratory? Did you? What was the elastic modulus that you have observed for steel? What was the elastic modulus? All of you have done the experiment, I suppose. You must have reported the elastic modulus as one of the outcomes of your experiment. Did you? What was the number? Louder? As a mechanical engineer, if you don't know, if you don't remember the elastic modulus of steel and yield strength of the steel, it is not acceptable. 200 newtons, 210 unit, GPA, 210, approximately 200, right? 210 GPA. But how come all of you got the same number? Or almost the same number, 200, 210, something like that. Obviously, the samples would not have been cut in the same direction. You take a block, and then if you have cut the sample in this direction, and I cut the sample in this direction, you will not know, once I give you the sample, right, whether I have cut in this direction or in this direction. But all of you have, all of you seem to have got the same number. You don't seem to observe any difference in elastic modulus. Why is that? Where is the isotropy coming from? Because the material that you have tested was not a single crystal material, it's a polycrystalline material. So when you have several of these orientations coming together and meeting at the grain boundaries, effectively all the anisotropy cancels out. And hence you will have you will measure the material property to be the same in all the directions. So for a polycrystalline material, not necessarily all the time, if it doesn't have any texture, then the material property will be isotropic. For instance, elastic modulus, you would measure it to be same in all the directions. That is why it did not matter whether the sample is being cut in the longitudinal direction or a transverse.